Good afternoon. Welcome to Our Lady Star of the Sea on this 25th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Please stand now and join with me in singing our opening hymn, Sing to the Mountains, found in music issue number 538, number 538 in the music issue.
Jesus, you call sinners into your all-embracing love and compassion. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you gave yourself as a ransom for all. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, in you is our hope and our salvation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Grant that by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Hear this, you who trample upon the needy and destroy the poor of the land. When will the new moon be over, you ask, that we might sell our grain, and a Sabbath, that we may display the wheat? We will diminish the ephah and add to the shekel, and fix our scales for cheating. We will buy the lowly for silver, and the poor for a pair of sandals. Even the refuse of the wheat we will sell. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, never will I forget a thing you have done. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Then, that in every place the men should pray, lifting up
or argument. The word of the Lord.
Judah, the kingdom of Judah, to go to Israel
and there to preach God's word to the people there. And what we see is he is an outsider when he goes there. He is just astounded at what he sees. There's cheating, there is exploitation, buying people for a sandal or a pair of sandals, cheating with scales, all kinds of deceit. And it's all in service of the mighty shekel, the money, and their own pleasure. And so he speaks God's word that God will not forget this, that you need to change. And of course, he may have been speaking to the wall over there for the effect that he had, because this guy's from a different kingdom. He's talking to us like this. And for them, it had become so normal, that kind of currency of business. And so that they didn't even see it as wrong. Such it had become hardened in their hearts. So this is really what this the parable is speaking about, is ultimately the role of money and that money sometimes has over our lives. You know, I started thinking about this. Jesus speaks a lot about money in the gospel. Have you ever notice that? Yeah. And it's not looking for it. It's just to say, what does it do to you? So today in this parable, we find, again, there is a disreputable person at the center of the parable. And when Jesus teaches, many of these parables are like that. The prodigal son is disreputable. The Samaritan is a disreputable character, but they're often found in the parables that Jesus is talking about. But this parable stands in a class of all its own. The roguish character is praised by the master. He's doing something quite dishonest, don't you think? And yet he's praised by the master. And so what does this? It suggests that what this guy has been doing is to be emulated by others. But the key to understanding the parable, it lies in where the dishonesty is in the story. And the most obvious sense, the dishonesty reveals itself in his going to the debtors and reducing their debt. That's pretty dishonest. But yet, that's not where the dishonesty in this parable lies. Because he has been dismissed prior to going to those debtors and saying, here, let's fix up your bills, right? He's already been called out and is about to be dismissed. But according to the story, the dishonesty lies either in his incompetence or in something the way he was managing the property. What is in fact the steward doing? The parable, it envisages a situation of an ordinary landowner in those days who would have a steward, an agent that would go and collect the bills of these various properties for him. And so what it envisages is that the manager, he has a certain amount of authority, and he goes around and sets the leasing prices and signs the agreements, and he also gets a commission for himself, a cut of the deal. Just like tax collecting in those days, tax collectors would try to get as much of a commission they can to go into their own pocket, then to give it to the Romans later. Likewise, this is what's going on here. So there's nothing particularly dishonest in that. But what the steward does after receiving notice of dismissal is to strip away the portion that he was collecting. That way he could reduce the price owed by the debtors. And that's why it was so attractive and creative in a way, because he wasn't defrauding the master. He was returning, basically, and letting go of all the commissions that he had made in the course of things. And that made it creative. Because in that system is that sharecroppers, even in our own day and age, sharecroppers are almost always in debt. You know, you have a bad season, you get drought, you get insects, you get fires, the whole bit. And so these are always repaying. and he'll never get out of debt. And so in doing this, by letting go of his own kind of collection of commissions, he's able to reduce the debt. And of course, that makes the people who have gotten the reduction, it makes them hopeful. Because a debt that seems insurmountable perhaps is in sight. And then also another side effect is, it made the landowner look good. Because those people thought he was representing the landowner when he reduced that. So they're giving thanks to the landowner. And what he's doing also is storing up for a future, for his own position in the future, as he no longer has a job. And so the parable really then refers to the great reversal that will take place in the coming of the kingdom. That is, when the Lord will raise up the lowly and send the rich away empty. So that the idea is the poor will receive that prominent place, privileged paid place in God's kingdom. And that those who have in this life were able to relinquish their own wealth in service of giving alms to the poor. It is the poor that will welcome them into the kingdom. And in the Gospel of Luke, the only use for money is to give away, to give others that they would have life. And this is the radical message that this parable is trying to give. And what's good about this, or the meaning for me, I think, is that it was the radical letting go of the steward, letting go of his own wealth in order to store up treasure in heaven, and ultimately, in the long run, be welcomed by those for whom he let go of his treasure, so that they could have life, an adequate way of life. Well, that's all I got. So, as a people of faith, let us now stand and profess that which lies at the center of our lives, saying, I believe in one God. St. Paul asked Timothy that his prayers and petitions be offered for everyone. We follow Paul's counsel today, making our prayers and petitions for all of God's children.
For the church, that Christ cleanse every disciple from greed to love and serve him before all things. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who exercise authority, that they may be honest and trustworthy in handling the matters that are entrusted to them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer in poverty and all who struggle to make ends meet, that they may be lifted model the trustworthy behavior they expect from young people. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who gather at this table, especially the sorrowful and lonely, may we find joy and peace in God's presence. Let us pray to the Lord. For our beloved dead, that they may receive the reward of eternal life, especially Patricia Halsey and Kathleen Joan Coughlin, in whose memory we celebrate this Eucharist, and for our most recently departed, Bob King. May they be admitted to the company of saints, and may those who mourn their loss be comforted. Let us pray to the Lord. For all the needs we hold close to our hearts, and all of our intentions, spoken and unspoken. Let us pray to the Lord.
Gracious God, you guide us in the responsible use of the wealth of your creation. Grant us the grace to share your goodness with those most in need as you hear all our prayers through our teacher and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but
us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, gracious to grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer to those near us some gesture of our peace in Christ.
Thank you.
announcements today. The first is that on Tuesday of this week at 11 o'clock, we will celebrate the funeral for Bob King, who died last week. It's not too late to sign up for Children's Faith Formation. That includes confirmation. And same thing as with the RCIA. If anybody's interested in the rite of Christian initiation for adults, some of you know might want to enter the full communion with the Catholic Church or someone who has been baptized, you're welcome to invite them to that. That takes place on Tuesday evenings at 6:30. It hasn't begun yet, though. That's why we're still taking entries into that. A concert of classic music for soprano and piano will be presented by our cantor Susan Hecht and our music director Alice, and that will take place on October 2nd at 2 o'clock. Is that a Sunday?
Yes.
Okay, Sunday, October 2 at 2. Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption, both in mystery and in manner of our life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God, bless us and keep us this night, and bring us to our beds in peace, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us walk this week in the light and in the love of Christ Jesus.
As we go now to serve the Lord, let us sing our closing hymn together, Blessed Be the Lord, found in the music issue, number 444, number 444 in the music issue.